So, Babaji, do you need to say anything here? You want to say anything here?
Very nice.
Thank you. So, you see, Yama and Markandeya. So, this is another story that I would like to add. And Yama and Markandeya. Markandeya was a rishi. Okay. So, they say the Maheshwaris are also from his lineage. Markandeya Rishi has this thing. His parents did not have any children. So both of them collectively did a long penance, austere penance, for his being born to them. And Lord Shiva says that I give you a choice. Lord Shiva says that you can have a choice of having a son who is long-lived but is absolutely dumb, is not intelligent at all. Or you can have a very intelligent, very beautiful, very loving child, but he will survive only for 16 years of life. So the parents say that we might as well have a child who has a very strong, all these qualities for 16 years of his life. So Markandeya is born. Again, now, he shows all the traits of good traits, of intelligence, of being... You know, they say that there's 36 gunas that a person can have. And it said that Krishna had all these gunas. Okay. Sterling qualities. So, Markandeya shows a reflection of these sterling qualities. Intelligence and goodness of heart and, you know, ability to attract people and all these things. But his parents know that the 16th birthday is approaching. And life is short. Kal, time, Yama are after him. So on the eve of his 16th birthday, they're they're very, very sad. A parent knowing that the child has no future, it's something very dangerous for the parent. You cannot even think about it. So they're in that state, that unhappy, grievous state. And so he says that tomorrow is my birthday. Why are you people so low-keyed? Today you should be celebrating that I, you know, 16th year is supposed to be a very, very big year in a child, in a boy's life. Okay. So he says that you should be happy then. So they say that we have nothing to be happy about. And on further questioning, he comes to know, Markandeya comes to know that Markandeya is told that he has only one day to survive. So he says, why am I wasting my time? Don't worry about me. I will come back. And he just goes and he makes a linga, Shivalinga. And he just sits there and he's into here and now. Most of us do puja, including me. How do we do puja? We do with saying the mantras and our mind is going on a different route. Our tongue travels on a different route and our mind travels on a different route. But to attain the entire, but we know that wherever attention goes, energy flows. So when you're doing the mantras, if you are doing it with the focus only on the mantras, the entire energy goes there. And even the lords are pleased because your energy is focused on that being, celestial or otherwise. The celestial being doesn't have any other alternative but to answer to you. So he was so much in, you know, we've heard so many examples as such. I'm just, Babaji, that's what I'm trying to say is, see, we know of Dhruv, we know of Prahlad, Markandeya, all these young children, you know, they show such a tough, or rather a focused attitude, focused love towards the divine, that the divine has no option but to come to their rescue. So when Kal came, when Lord Yama came to, you know, take his life away, Lord, and he was like, he just held Lord Shiva and said, save me. Shiva, Shiva, Shiva. That was all he was saying. Om Namah Shiva. And then it is said that Lord Shiva himself came up and said, I'm going to kill you for even coming near my devotee. So Bharani people understand protocol, okay, and they will go to superior protocol, but they're always very dutiful. If they are on duty, they do not consider anybody, even family members they do not consider, which we will see when we are talking about the case of Yama and the Pandavas. Okay, so I have told you that. So let me see if I have an example here. I do. Okay, we have moved quite down. Anyways, which we will see in case of Yama and the Pandavas, and we will take up a case in this here. So there are 2-3 cases. The first, I think I'll just take this case as far as Yama testing his own. Which story would you want me to take up, Bhavaji?
This is the one where they fall down after drinking the water.
Yes. Yeah. So it's a very Yakshpuran. It comes from the one... Yaksh Samvad in Bhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavatam, there is this chapter called Yaksh Samvad between Yudhishthir and the Yaksha, okay, who later turns out to be Yama. So I can take this up or whichever one you want, or the
that one Swarga.
Okay. See, we don't have that much of time. It's a lack of time. As I told you, in my nakshatra classes, we do it for, say, 4 hours, for four and a half, 5 hours for every nakshatra. So, we don't have much time to cover so many, examples, stories. I'm just doing... So, this is an example of Yama and the Pandavas. I have already told earlier on that Yudhishthir is a son bestowed on Devi Kunti, Mata Kunti, by Pandu, by Lord Yama. Okay, because Pandu has been cursed by a rishi and his wife when they were mating. They were in the forest roaming as deer and doe, stag and doe, and they were mating. And this Pandu shoots a deer and a doe, and it is amongst the rules of principles of shooting or what do they say, hunting, that you are not supposed to hunt an animal when it is with its partner. And Pandu goes against that and he hunts that, and so the rishi curses him that when you approach your wives, any one of your wives, with the feelings of conjugal life, there and then you will die. So Pandu cannot have children with his wife. Okay. Two wives. So now, the first one to be called upon, and Kunti has been bestowed by Rishi Dravasa, a boon because of her utter servitude towards him, a boon that she has the ability to call any of these divine powers and bestow a child upon, a son upon her. So because Pandu cannot have a child with Kunti, so the first one to bestow the child is, they say, he should be, Pandu says that the child should be extremely on the righteous path, should be able to guide his younger siblings. So Pandu asks Kunti to call Yamaraj to bestow a child, and Yamaraj, that is Dharmaraj also, he is called upon and he bestows a child, Yudhishthir. Now, back to the current scenario. Yudhishthir and his brothers have been after the Dhrut Krida, or the game of dice, or the insult of Draupadi in the Sabha, in the assembly, it so happens that they have been given a vanvas, or the movement in the forest, as sannyasis, as monks, as atheists, into aesthetics, into the forest. So they are asked to live in the forest for 13 years and 1 year of agyatvas, or 1 year of staying in a hideout such that, yes. So they are not recognized by anybody. Now it so happens that one day, Draupadi is very thirsty. And Yudhishthir also has left his sandals near the hut. And all of a sudden, they see that a deer comes, stag comes, takes those sandals in his head, and he runs away. So what Nakula does is, he says, I'll go and find the deer, and I'll also get water. He runs after the deer, and he comes across a pond. And he sees the deer there. And so he's just on the verge of catching the deer when he hears, and drink water. He says, okay, let me quench my thirst. And he says he's going to drink the water. And there is a voice, booming voice. The deer moves away somewhere, and they hear a booming voice that Nakula hears a booming voice that, don't touch the water of this lake or you will die. Answer my question first. So Nakula says, what nonsense. He drinks the water and he falls dead. Now Nakula is not back. So Sahadev is sent. Similarly, it happens with all the four brothers. Till Arjuna and Bhim also is sent, and this happens. Now while this is happening, what Nakula does is, Draupadi is very, very restless because she can't find water and her husbands are missing. Both the things. She's extremely thirsty and her husbands are missing. And then they're worried, basically, Yudhishthir and Draupadi. So Yudhishthir says, I'll go and find my brothers. Once he moves, what he sees is, he also comes searching in near the pond, lake. And as he's about to take the water, again he too hears the same voice. So, they keep talking, and so he says, he pays heed to the voice. He says, you come in front of me. So the divine, in form of a yaksha is another celestial being, a very ferocious celestial being, and they are guardians of wealth. Okay,
because they are descendants of Kuber.
Exactly, they are descendants of Kuber, the god of wealth.
Treasurer.
The treasurer of the gods. Okay. So the Yaksha, he's a ferocious form. Okay. And, but Yudhishthir has a calm heart and mind. So Yudhishthir says that, okay, what can I do for you? So he says that, until and unless you answer my questions, you cannot drink the water. So Yudhishthir says, okay, I can answer your questions. I will answer your questions. So, Yudhishthir says, but what happened? How he is in a state of sorrow also, because he's seeing his four brothers in this platform, dead people who are Maharathis, you know, who can kill an entire army. So how did they die? And they have no sign on their body of any, you know, struggle or fight or anything. So the Yaksha said, I had asked them questions, and I had asked them not to drink water. They simply did not listen to me, and they died because of consuming that water. So Yudhishthir says, okay, I'll answer the questions. So they go about asking, and the Yaksha Puran is said to be one beautiful, and having read a part of it, I can just tell you that it's very enlightening part. It gives you an insight into life and what we are missing, what we don't even recognize, what we don't even want to read, or because they're very troubling kind of a questions. Okay, so one of the questions, the two, three questions that were very profound and like to share over here. One question is, that is asked is, what is the jati of a person born? Okay, what is the caste of a person born? So Yudhishthir says, the caste of a person who is born, a Navjat Shishu, or a child, a newborn child, is born as a Shudra. He's born from the muck. He comes out of the muck. He's all into blood. He's all into sweat. All fecal matter, urine, and everything. He's born as a Shudra. And then what he decides to do in life, talks about his caste. So the caste system that is so very prevalent today is actually not the caste system of the Vedic ages. And it has been proved in the Yakshapuran. Okay, I'm not stating something that is mine. I'm quoting from a classical text.
Yeah, in fact, he also says this, later on he also says it's there in the Mahabharata that we cannot decide the caste by birth because there's a lot of inter-caste marriages which have happened and there is the Varnashram system have been damaged. So you cannot say that somebody who is born in a Brahmin family is a Brahmin. And this he said 5,000 years back when the Kali Yuga had not yet started.
So and in that, Kali Yuga, we say Brahmin. We say Brahmin with a stamp.
In fact, I sent you a photo that day, if you remember.
No. We have lost, you know, we have lost all essence of the real religion. A Brahmin is a person who has a strong Jupiter and doing Adhyan.
Yes.
Or study.
Brahma janeti ti Brahmin. One who knows the science of spirituality is a Brahmin.
So, this is something that so this is one question he answers. Then, another profound question that is asked here is, so what is the most surprising thing in the world? So Yudhishthir says that every day around us, we see thousands of people dying. Okay. Every day you hear at least some family member or some attached member or somewhere you get to know that this person has passed away or this person is under this disease or something like that. We all hear something. But we never question our own morality. We think we are immortal. And I always say we think that we've had some part of that amrit, that nectar, and come on this planet. We think we are not going to die. That is why we do such a lot of all that possible, you know, or trying to grab this, grab that. At the end, when we are going, and Yama is actually taking us, they don't even leave, at least for those who are being cremated. They don't even leave that white cloth on you. So, what are we going to take from here? It's only our karmic deeds that is going to be counted by Yama's assistant, Chitragupta. No land, no money, nothing is going with us. So, he says, Yudhishthir says, that we see people dying around us, but we never question our own morality, our own moral status. Mortal status. We think we are immortals, and that is why we go around doing things that we do, as a result of which our karmakan is absolutely shattered. So there's an entire repertoire of question and answer that happens between the father and the child, and the father is very, very happy. Okay, and says, okay, you are on the right path, and I'm happy with you. So you can choose another brother to live with you. I'll give him life. So he says, make sure that it is Sahadev. So now, what should have been anybody's reaction in that case? They would have asked for Arjun, because Arjun was the Maharathi. He had the ability to kill anybody. Arjun was known for his prowess in the battle, and they had to win the battle. Or he could have asked for Bhim. Bhim was equally, you know, known for having, and Bhim had a pratigya for killing the 100 sons of, for Draupadi's sake and things like that. But he says, make sure that it is Sahadev. So, again, Yama is like happy and yet flabbergasted. This is why. So he says, see, my father had two wives, Kunti and Madri. So I, as a son of Kunti, am surviving. So one from Madri should also survive. So Madri's sons are Nakul and Sahadev. So I am the eldest and Sahadev the youngest. So I want him to live. So Yama is so happy, says Tathastu, and may all of your brothers live. So he gives. So Bharani Nakshatra people will be testing others about their I am not able to get a word in English, you know, their worth, actually, their worth. The English word is worth. Before giving people what is due. And they can give more than what is due. Having decided on the worth of the person. That is what Bharani does. So the key point here would be,
In fact, I forgot to say something when you had shown, you know, that they were deciding whom to invite first when Kunti and Pandu were deciding.
Yes.
To invite first, you know, because whoever you invite first, he will sit on the throne because he'll be the eldest.
Yes.
So then Kunti suggested that I think we should invite Indra first because
yes.
The son which we get, he will be the most heroic. Yes. Or she said that I think, or we can invite Pavan, the god of the wind, because he will be the most strongest.
Powerful, then most powerful.
Pandu said that it's great that heroism and power, these two are together. It's great, but to sit in the throne, these two are not enough. You should be perfectly righteous first, follower of religious principles and dharma. And along with that, if you have these two, then only there is the use of a king. So it's a very big lesson for people these days, and the election is also there in India. So it's not that, you know, you select somebody who is very heroic or somebody who is very powerful, you know, we will show who you are. But if Yudhishthir is not there, that kingdom
will not last. Exactly. So even with their own children, you know, these people with Bharani Nakshatra, I have observed. Even with their own children, they do not give things, just pass it on. They make sure that their children deserve it before they pass their values down to their children. So, you know, when we are talking about deserving cases, this is one point that I really do love to make. So I'll tell you the story of Chitragupta. Chitragupta is said to be the confident, you know, you have somebody who is your secretary, okay, and somebody who is in your good books, or who maintains your records. You have an accountant, okay, and Chitragupta is the accountant of Lord Yama. So Lord Yama will simply ask, you know, the boss does not do all the hard work. If the hard work is done by the secretary or the accountant, and says, excuse me, can you please tell me that man's balance? That is what the boss actually does. So everything goes to Chitragupta. And imagine a celestial power, a celestial being, the mother computer, if I can say so, sitting and accounting for each and every organism, not just on this planet, the entire universe in his systems. That is what Chitragupta does. The zero balance of Libra over there. Can you see? The debits and credits are being balanced. A balance near Chitragupta. It's just a depiction of who and what you are. How it is taken as. So he's reading it out from his books, his ledgers, you know, what you're doing and how you're doing. And so you will have one loyal assistant or one confidant. And I know people who have planets in Bharani, if it is afflicted, like we see in the case of Clarence Thomas, okay? He's afflicted by Rahu, okay? And he was, by his own assistant, a former assistant of his, she said that, you know, he had she accused him of sexual harassment. That is, I told you, you know, if there is some affliction, you said moon, I sure some Rahu influence on the moon. Fifth, seventh, something, if you recall that person chart, you will see fifth, third, seventh, some influence would be there of Rahu on this moon.
I know what you're saying.
Yeah. So you see, this person will, she said that it was a very big case in US. It was a very, very big case in US. You know, a judge for the Supreme Court, okay, is alleged with something as big as sexual assault. Sexual harassment in US is a big, big crime. So she accused him of that, and he denied, and there was a long overdrawn case. At last, he won the confirmation, but there was a lot of pros and cons going on there. So you see, Rahu is aspecting this. Again, Saturn is aspecting this from the seventh house to the fourth house. Okay, and Saturn is the second law of morality, moral values and ethics, sitting in the seventh house of opposition, second seventh house of open enemies, and from that seventh house he is aspecting the tenth house.